Hi, this is Chris Nielsen with Breaking Up with Fear. I have the pleasure today to have Kate Leach with me, and we're going to talk about stories about breaking up with fear. Kate, please introduce yourself.
Well, thank you so much for having me, Chris. I'm really just honored to be here, a part of your new show, which I think is so timely. So my name is Kate, and I am a mom of seven and happily married for over 30 years. But I grew up and continued to live in fear for most of my adult life. I kind of, in the last couple of years, have overcome in a really big way where even just like doing something like this, a video, is absolutely unheard of in my prior to 50 years old life, you know.
Well, I'm glad you're here.
Yeah, so it's awesome, like letting go of worrying about what people think about me and just coming into self-acceptance has really push that fear out in such a big way that I'm just excited to be able to share my heart in a way that I'm no longer scared of what anybody thinks about me, you know?
I love that. And I love what you said, self-acceptance. I mean, I want to touch on that a little bit. You triggered me. How did you find self-acceptance for yourself?
So it's kind of, you know, one of these long, convoluted stories, but basically, my family and I had built a church body up, starting with a home church setting. With just a few families, we built it up over to 70 people, which was getting to be quite a lot for a home setting. And we didn't have really strong leadership. We were kind of the de facto leaders. And as we tried to bring leadership into it, we upset the people in the group. And so these were people that we'd raised our youngest kids with for over 10 years. We, you know, were together every single week and just really loved and were loyal to these people. Long story short, they ended up rejecting us and kicking us out of the group.
Wow.
And it was shocking and hurtful and devastating on a lot of levels. But through that, somehow I just kind of realized I've lived my entire life with this fear of rejection and always kind of worried about what people think about me. And so now the people in my life, you know, beyond my family that I cared about so much had rejected me. And I began to realize that it just doesn't matter what people think about you. You can't make anybody like you, no matter how much you love them, you know? And kind of coming into that self-acceptance that I am who I am, and not that I didn't make mistakes, I certainly did and do, you know,
Yeah.
but recognizing that I am who God made me to be, and I'm okay with that. And it just, so through that like severe rejection that hurt my family terribly, we have kind of like built ourselves up in confidence and self-acceptance and are able to kind of be more a better part of this world now because of it.
Thank you for sharing that story. And that had to be really difficult to go through. What helped you get on the other side of that rejection?
Well, I mean, to be honest, I spent a couple of months hardly able to breathe or get off the couch. And then I really started trying to research, like, how do you get past this, like, devastation when you just feel like you can't even move on anymore? You have, you know, because it was very confusing to us. It was sudden rather than like, you know, coming to us and telling us what what we'd done wrong. They just, it was a sudden and shocking thing for us. And so I went through processing and grieving because it was a loss. It was a very real loss. And so allowing myself to process and grieve, then I was kind of able to move into the next step, you know, and recognizing that that was, you know, forgiveness and repentance for our part, you know, but then self-acceptance just kind of flowed out of those experiences of grieving, processing, forgiving, and then recognizing, but I am who I am, you know, and I'm okay with that. And my self-confidence just totally blossomed. I mean, I still need to work on it. I'm an introvert at heart for sure, but yeah, it's been really an interesting journey. And at this point, we're incredibly grateful for that journey, even though it was so hard, because we've grown so much through it.
Yeah, and I bet you your journey can help others so much too. That I can the pain of losing people that you care about and been with so much in your life to that rejection, that super low point. What were there any particular steps or things that helped you find self-acceptance?
So, I think really looking at it from the side of how do we forgive, but also like owning our part, You know, they wouldn't tell us what our part was, so we really had to figure it out for ourselves.
Okay.
Nobody wanted to communicate with us, you know? And I think that kind of owning our part and recognizing it and doing our best to make amends for the parts that we had in making this dissatisfaction within the group was really helpful, because it helped us to know ourselves better, especially me. And but then recognizing there is a point, you know, everything's not my fault. Some of it's my fault, you know, but not bringing it all on me, which is, I think, from childhood kind of what I've always done, is that if something goes wrong, it's all my fault. Woe is me. I'm a terrible person. And, you know, my brain could go like that for months. And so through like the proper work and kind of brain work, because I did fall into like obsessive thinking where I think about the same conversation, the same scenario over and over and over again. And I didn't want to. I'd already thought about it 100 times. I did not need to think about it the 101st time, you know? Yeah. And so doing that brain work of really taking control of my thoughts and getting to know myself, I think was just through that journey, I got to know myself, and that led into acceptance.
Well, that's wonderful. I mean, to find acceptance any way you can is a gift. I know you're doing work and helping. Is it helping other women feel safe and secure? How did you come about that? How did that happen?
So out of this, I began a blog called Blessed Reject, because I really do feel that I've been blessed through this rejection. It's been wonderful at this point. And so I began that, wanting to share with women and men that have gone through this kind of thing, the journey of allowing yourself to process and grieve and going through the forgiveness and the owning your own stuff and, you know, all that. So I kind of created this blog that is that path that you can kind of follow through to come to that place yourself. And as I, you know, I'm now living in like the overcoming part of it, I there was still this component that was missing and that had fear in my heart, and that was feeling like secure and safe. I have 4 daughters, and I really have always wanted them to feel like they could defend themselves and that sort of thing, but I could never quite find the right, you know, taking a self-defense class is great, but if you don't practice it, you know, if you don't keep up on it, that sort of thing, or being in self-defense classes for years, it's like, if that's not their passion, then so I just kind of always felt lost as a mom in finding a way to help my girls be protected and feel that empowerment of knowing that whatever the situation comes up, they could deal with it, you know. Mm-hmm. So I finally found a fit for me, which was in personal protection. And now I've just jumped into it with both feet, because it is really empowering for women that are kind of coming into their own and into self-acceptance to be able to know that, you know, whatever happens to me, you know, if I'm in a parking lot and somebody's following me, I now know what to do. I know like the proper thing to do, the right thing to do to protect myself. And so, you know, I sell personal protection tools, and I do workshops to train women and girls. You know, this is something you really want to start with young girls, like even as young as like 10, to start helping them to recognize there's a lot of stuff like situational awareness that I was taught it some as a child, but it's kind of now I'll bring that term up to other women. They'll be like, what's that? And I'm like, really? You don't even know that? You know,
so what do you share with other women when you say situational awareness?
So I just talk about that it's being really aware of your situation. So it's in a parking lot, not having your head down in your phone, not being overburdened with bags and that sort of thing, or children, you know, being aware and ready, kind of. So just having your head up, kind of being aware of what's going on around you, knowing what to do if somebody's like staring at you and it's making you uncomfortable. You know, most women would say, well, I don't look at them and I just get in my car really quick and lock the door. But in reality, this is just a little tip. What you should do is stare them right in the eyes. Don't smile or anything, but let them know I see you and I could identify you. Mm-hmm. And then go get in your car. You know, stay confident, keep your shoulders up, your head up, and be aware of what's going on around you. Because even just that little bit of being aware of what's around you can oftentimes be the key. They'll choose somebody, you know, perpetrators will also choose somebody that's not paying attention, that kind of, you know, is down and just not, just like a depressed looking woman is way more attractive of a target than a woman that's confident and portraying that, even if you don't feel it inside, portray it on the outside.
Right, that makes so much sense in that someone that you lock eyes with, they know they've been seen. It's like a lot of times, I've done that as well. Sometimes I look away, so that's great, you know, point of view to just lock eyes. But it reminds me of when I'm riding a bike and I come to a four-way stop and there's cars. I want to lock eyes with the car when I'm a bike, when I'm on a bicycle, and go,
yes,
you see me, I see you.
Right.
I get to know.
Yeah, exactly. And it gives you the confidence to go ahead and ride in front of them because you know they saw you. Yeah, exactly. I love that.
Yeah. I love your situational awareness, and that just that simple tip is powerful. Any other things you would like to share around that?
So, you know, I have lots of great tips and just, you know, I'm learning as I go, but it's been incredibly, like, it gives you a peace of mind that you don't realize you're missing beforehand. I think in the back of all of our minds, we know that, well, we should have a plan, you know, to, if something bad happens, but most of us wait until something kind of hits either ourselves or somebody very close to us. And then like, okay, you know, now I need a home security system. Now I need a pepper spray, whatever, you know, but let's not wait until it's that close to us. You know, let's get prepared now. And what that ends up doing is giving you this peace of mind. It's like something that your subconscious is kind of like, for me, for years, it was like kind of just niggling at me to get my girls protected, but I couldn't figure it out. So it was just like this heaviness in the back of my subconscious. And now I've dealt with it and I deal with it. And so it's not hard. It is not hard to become prepared. You don't have to spend a bunch of time in classes, though I totally encourage taking them if you do have the time or the interest. But you can get educated very, very, you know, it's just like almost like make it a hobby to get educated. Get equipped, you know, figure out, talk to somebody like me that can help you choose the right tools or weapons that are going to work best for you. You know,
like what kind of tools or weapons do you use or have?
So I carry pepper spray and stun devices, Cubitons, which are like a force multiplying tool, which you can actually, you know, a flashlight can be a force multiplying tool. So, you know, if you're coming after me and I try to hit you, there's a good chance you're going to laugh at me as a, you know, bigger, stronger man, right? But if I come at you with a flashlight or a tool made for that, all of a sudden, you know, if I'm going for your eyes or your throat, I'm a little more dangerous now than if I'm just like, you know, trying to get you with my hands.
Yeah.
And so simple things like that, doesn't always have to be spending money. There's things around our houses that, you know, we all have, like a whistle, you know, just something like that. We don't know how we're going to react when we're scared to death, you know? And so we may lose our voice, but having a whistle also, you know, sadly in our culture, voices are often overlooked. When a woman or anybody is screaming for help, sometimes that's just overlooked, but something like a personal alarm or a whistle, it's a unique noise, and at the very least, it's going to draw eyes.
Yeah.
And you know, what the assailant does not want is eyes. So.
And just hitting on what you said earlier, all this work you've done to feel safer and help your daughters feel safer, and I love that you're doing that for your daughters. I have a daughter as well, and I always want her. You know, I've taken martial arts training in the past, and that helped me actually not be aggressive, but actually just feel more confident in myself.
Yes.
And more relaxed in situations. Is that what it's done for you? It sounds like it's made you more relaxed in being you.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. It's taken away a fear that maybe I didn't like consciously really realize I had. I had it for my daughters, you know, because that mom thing or dad thing in us that wants to protect. But now that I am aware and I am ready come what may, I don't have that fear anymore. You know, it's like gone. It's like, I'm just, whatever happens, happens, but I have a plan of how I would deal with it. And it's definitely not like a cookie cutter plan. I mean, there's not, I'm sure, you know, being in martial arts, that it's having the adaptability. You know, I actually carry 3 different tools on my keychain, and you know, and I'm not going to have my pepper spray out in bad weather or windy weather. It could totally come back at me.
Yeah.
Not a great idea, right?
Right.
So a stun device, they have to be, you know, that's contact. That's going to be somebody who's right on me. So, and then the Cubitan, you know, I wouldn't give that to my grandma. She's not going to have the force behind it, even though it's better than her hand, you know?
Yeah.
So it's very personal what's going to work for you and what you're comfortable with. A lot of women are not comfortable with stun devices until they actually hold one, you know, and see that, oh, it doesn't hurt to turn it on. You know, they think it's going to like shock them or something. So yeah, there's a lot available, and it's easy to learn.
So once do you help then people learn how to use all this? Is that what
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Okay. So I do workshops, and then I also, when somebody buys something from me, I just work with them personally. What I really encourage is women learning muscle and mind memory. So you want to, you know, not just own a tool, you want to rehearse what you would do with the tool. So let me just grab Okay, so this is one of my Cubitons. So it's just a, you know, it's got like grippy material here and a finger notch here. So, and you know, your keys can be on here. So I could just be walking very casually, you know, with my keys, and nobody can really tell what that is. It's some weird looking thing, right? So if I just get in the habit, it's really a habit of holding your tool when you're walking, or, you know, pretty much nowadays anywhere. It used to be the dark parking lot, right? But now it can happen in front of the nice movie theater in the middle of the day. So you just want to get in the habit of holding your tool and then thinking through, reminding yourself, how do I use it? What would I go for with this? Okay, if I was being attacked, what part of their body would I want to aim for? And just going through that in your mind, and kind of just doing a quick rehearsal, even once a week, that's great, because it keeps it at the front of the mind. Owning these tools does nobody any good. Mm-hmm. It's knowing how to use them and knowing where they are. So many times I'll run into women that say, oh, I have a pepper spray. And I'm like, really, where is it? Oh, it's somewhere in my purse. Well, you've seen women's purses, right? Yeah, if you can't have it in your hands when you need it, it's useless. It's a waste of space and money, you know, so.
Was there any particular, was it all just the mass media fear that got this coming towards you that made you take this step? Or was it the fear of a specific incident that happened that?
So it was really that kind of getting past my fears in rejection in that area that kind of gave me, I had always had this desire for my girls. My girls are strong, independent women who want to go travel the world. And, you know, my 21-year-old's going to the Grand Canyon with a girlfriend next week. And I'm like, okay, you know, they're grown-ups.
Right.
But knowing that she knows what to do and how to protect herself is just, so it really is kind of that mama's peace of mind. I haven't personally been a victim of violent crime, and I don't plan to be, but I do know what I would do if I was, and my girls are ready too. So it was kind of that strength that I gained from getting past my fear of people that then I was able to jump into this.
And this is just kind of repeating a little bit what I said, but see if this feels true. Does all this preparation make you feel more peaceful inside?
It really does. Yeah. And it's not, you know, I say this a lot. It is not about being scared. It's not about fear. It's about being prepared. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we all want to be prepared. You know, how many of us stocked up on toilet paper? Because we wanted to be prepared, right? You know? Yeah. And so this is just about being prepared, because we do live in a violent world, and pretending like we don't doesn't help any of us, you know? And, you know, hopefully it will all end up being a waste of time and money, anything you do in this area, but really it won't be a waste, because it will have given you that peace of mind. You know, I mean, you don't want anybody to run into a situation where they actually have to use these things.
Right. Yeah. Thank you for saying all that. How would people get in touch with you if they wanted to talk about these different things with you?
So my website is blessedreject.com, and there is a whole category of protection that you might want to check out. But if you're looking for help with rejection, there's a lot on there too, on that path of overcoming and to thriving again. I'm also very active on Facebook. I actually have a Facebook group called Armed and Beautiful, where I do a lot of tips and training. And just if you want to just like start picking up some of the tips I've thrown out today, you know, I'm always throwing those kind of tips out for the gals in my group. And I'd love to have you join me on that. So it's Armed and Beautiful Facebook group, and Kate Leach on Facebook. Go ahead and connect. And yeah, I would love to have any woman that this has kind of pricked your heart that like, I would like that peace of mind, you know?
Well, thank you for sharing this. And for me too, you know, martial arts brought some peace inside because I wasn't as fearful in different situations. And I know this, just in the reason why I'm creating of this channel, is that my goal is to bring down the fear all over the place. And if we're less fearful, right, we do less hurtful things to others, we say less hurtful things to others, and we say less hurtful things even to ourselves.
Exactly. Yeah. I love your channel and what you're doing here. I just think it's an amazing thing to be doing. And yeah, you know, I hone in on women as are my target audience because that's who I can relate to. But, you know, my husband has a stun device and various tools that he keeps with him. You know, as we get older, we don't have the strength of a 25-year-old anymore, right? Yeah. And so it can definitely be something for everybody. And it does bring the fear level down when you feel like, I know what I'm doing. And you also kind of come to that place where it's not like I think, oh, whatever happens, I can totally protect myself. I don't think that, yeah. You know, that would be silly to think that. But I do know that I would have a fighting chance and I'm okay. You know, you kind of come to terms with whatever happens does happen, but I'm going to give it my best shot.
Yeah, I love that too. I mean, yeah, I don't want to get in any fight with anyone too. I've not searched out any of that. But yeah, it's good to be prepared in some way and for all that. So we feel peaceful inside. And I think it's the insecure people out there that feel super insecure sometimes are the most dangerous.
Right.
That if you feel good about yourself and what you're doing, you'd be less insecure in terms of reaching out and maybe hurting someone else or yourself.
Right. I agree completely. Yeah.
Thank you so much for being here and sharing your stories. And please reach out to Kate if that makes sense for you.
Thank you so much, Chris. This has just been delightful chatting with you.
Thank you, Kate.